Good morning. Actually, let's do this a little bit more appropriate. Merry Christmas. All right, we are so glad you're here. A couple of things to let you know. There's nothing else today. This is our Christmas worship. And then right after this, you go home and fill yourself up with whatever ham or turkey or whatever you got. Okay, but it is a day that... Then with family, the office will be closed Monday and Tuesday. So if you have anything for her, get it back to us on Wednesday. I will be around. I'll be in Richmond tomorrow picking up my wife. So I'm excited to be able to say she is coming back. But it is Christmas Day. She is down at the farm with like 50 bison They are in total depression because the Eagles lost and they're blaming Lisa. We bought some Philadelphia Eagle onesies for Sammy and she put them on him backwards. All right, so we're blaming Lisa for the Cowboys win. So it's such as, be careful, I'll have Diane slap you in the back of the head, Cecil. Merry Christmas. So nothing this week, this afternoon, nothing Wednesday as well. So spend time with your family, maybe check with people and make sure they're all doing okay. And then starting in January, we're kicking off some great stuff, so get back here next Sunday, hear more about it. Paul, you want to share something in a minute? Come on up. Well, we all know that in my family, Lisa does the work, and David's family is Holly, but Gene has nobody.
Okay.
Thank you. Let us start off with the responsive reading. While I'm doing the responsive reading, if there's anybody here that has Christmas lights in your beard, I'm going to ask, while we're doing the responsive reading, would you come down and light all five of our candles? Can you do that? Let's all stand. Have a responsive reading on the screen. I will be the leader, you will be the all, okay? Next slide. Go back to the responsive reading. So, you go ahead and start, you can do all that. But we are here, it is the candles of hope, it is the candles of peace, the candles of joy, the candle of love, and obviously the heart of Christmas is the Christ candle as we light that as well. So I'm the white, y'all are the yellow, all right? The Word of God has taken on flesh. You are a wonderful counselor. You are the one who spoke, and the world came into being. Emmanuel, you are the mighty God. The love that holds all together has revealed himself to us. Loving God, you are the everlasting Father. O Son of God, you have come and walked among your people. Almighty God, you are the Prince of Peace. You, the light of the world, come on a dark and quiet night. You shine in the darkness and you guide our way. You still shine and you still love. You are still here with us. Emmanuel, may your love be seen in and through us. Now we come to worship. We come to worship you. We lift our voices. We proclaim your love. We cry to the world, join us. Come and worship. Come and worship. Worship Christ, the newborn King. Amen. You may be seated. I'd like to introduce our service with a concept of chaos. Many of y'all on Christmas Eve had the idea of you're going to get all your boxes and you're going to put all these things together and it's all going to work out. And it all comes to pieces and you're up about 3 o'clock in the morning trying to figure what are you going to do. About 2 weeks ago, I put our little archway out there, and I started putting it together, and I realized with all the junk they sent me, they missed three beams. But they sent me 6 extra screws. I'm not exactly sure how that all fit together. So I adapted and made it shorter than it actually was supposed to be. I texted them, and this is what amazing. Amazon, 2 weeks before Christmas, I texted them, and within 20 minutes, they answered and said, which pieces are missing? And within 2 hours of my response, they had them in the mail to me. Now, that's great, but if it's Christmas Eve and you're putting an IKEA bookshelf together and you're missing a shelf, you know, mama ain't going to be happy. And pieces kind of come together. About 200 years ago, one of the greatest poets in American history, Henry Wadsworth, Longfellow. His middle name's just weird. I mean, who names their kid Wadsworth? Okay, let's just kind of go with that. Longfellow, he had gotten married, was the prime of his career, even in his 20s. He was acknowledged as a great poet, a great author. He had started to work at some college, and then he got hired by Harvard. He's doing great. He meets the love of his life, and the next thing that happens, this is back in the early 1800s, his wife gets sick and dies from illness. He goes into a great state of depression and a great state of despair. And then, fortunately, love struck again 7 years later. And he married his wonderful wife and his second wife, and then he had some great children and some sons. And then some things started to happen. His wife was trying to light some logs, which is unusual because my gas logs went out. And so I'm sitting here trying to relight it. I'm thinking, what's going to happen if I blow up the parsonage, okay, with Lisa gone? Because normally if she was here, I would blame her, okay? But I couldn't do that. So I'm down there trying to light it, and I'm thinking of the Henry Longfellow story, and his wife was trying to light something on fire, and she actually caught her clothes on fire. And the next thing that happened is she literally burned to death. He lost his wife to fire. And he was down there literally trying to save her, and he could not. And his face became so scarred that at that point, he decided to grow a beard to hide the scars. So first, I want to ask, Matt, what did Beverly do to you? Okay, that you had to grow the beard. Okay, it's probably the children. If children do leave scars, they do. Or David Detweiler's, you know, who knows what Holly does. You know, we're just going to leave your family life alone for a little bit. But, so he's hiding the scars, and he literally dove back into depression. And then America started to just become a turmoil. Nation divided. And there he was, in a state of depression. And the next thing you know, the Civil War breaks out. His son is called into service for the Union. His son is wounded in battle in Northern Virginia. And so he has lost his wife, the first wife. He loses his second wife. He has his son has been shipped back to Boston where he is caring for his son. And he walks around town and he sees the turmoil on people's faces of widows because they lost their husbands, of parents that have lost their children, of children that have lost their dad. He said, the nation is dark. The time is evil. And the world is never going to be able to get back together. Darkness is overtaking the light. And on Christmas Eve, he starts walking around snow-laden Boston. And on Christmas morning, he comes back into his house and he writes a poem. And the one thing that changed between when he went out and when he came in is he heard the church bells. And the part of the song is really dark and really deep. That the darkness is overtaking the light, and there are some stanzas we don't even sing anymore about the war, about young boys, young men losing their lives, a nation ripping asunder. But the words of the song come out very powerful with hope and a message that God is not dead because he is alive, and I heard the bells on Christmas Day. Probably one of the greatest poems Longfellow ever wrote, from the depth of depression, a glimmer of hope, because God is still alive. And that is what I want us to remember today. A few decades later, his poem was put to music. And it's a powerful song that I think will open our eyes and our hearts this morning. Thank you. I think the Lord needs a hand on that one. Amen, God. Amen. As our praise team makes their way up, let me read those words again. It was in a world of chaos, and it's this: there is no peace on earth. Hate is strong. Mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill toward men. It is, if you look out, it is hate. It is dark. It is madness. Then pealed the bells, more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill toward men. God is alive. He came to earth in the form of a baby. He came to show us the way to be the light and to call us out of darkness into marvelous light. And I can think of Christmas as we think of joyous and celebration. It is not about a guy in a red suit. It is about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we are to sing today I love Jingle Bells. I love, you know, Rudolph. I love all those. But no, we are singing to the King. And that should make our voices loud. Would we stand as we sing? Sing to the King in glory. Let there be praise. Amen. Before you sit down, tell two people God loves you. Can you tell them that? Two people. And y'all may be seated. I need two mics. God love you, Courtney. Holly, you're in the middle because it's him and her and him's on that side. Yeah, I know.
You got to watch the back.
Okay, black's working. Black's working. Is purple working?
Yep. Check. It was. They had me.
Okay. Got purple on?
Yeah.
Actually, you're not going to say much. You can share with black. For the last 4 weeks, we have been doing Sunday School Synergy, introducing some different classes. Now, I realized a couple of things. One, when I was sending David out to hold the mic for a lot of the seniors, he didn't know a lot of the seniors. Because, he's hanging around all these little prepubescent adolescents going through puberty type people, and it's kind of crazy. So I thought we would do a staff synergy, and what a great week to do this, the week that my wife's not here and I can't embarrass her. So I said, what other staff could I embarrass?
Should have been out of town.
Yeah, you should have been out of town. Too bad. So all they have to do is point. This is real good for husbands and wives, because whose fault is it? You always put it here. Now, you can point to yourself, or you can point to your spouse. I'm going to ask some simple questions. Now, y'all may try to guess. So, we'll start off with...
Is this the case you need to point louder?
Yeah, I'll hold that because she may want to correct me. Let's go back to before you were married. All right? If you don't know, if you're a guest with us, let me start this off. This is David Detwiler, our youth pastor, his wife, Holly. And we're not really, if you want to know more about them, they are willing to talk to you anytime, anywhere, invite them over food, whatever, or promise to babysit. That would probably get a conversation going really easy, okay? Number one, who noticed whom first? So you noticed her first.
Okay. Who liked her first or who noticed?
Who noticed the other person first? So you noticed Holly first. Okay. Who was better in school? See, this is why I took the mic from her. So,
she studied hard. I just showed up for this. I don't
know. He just got A's anyway.
Got A's anyway. Who has the better sense of humor?
It's a dark sense of humor.
All right, let's go. Do you want Christmas or do you want family? Let's go with Christmas. Who opened their gifts first? Who cleaned up all the wrapping mess? Ooh, very good. Who gives the best Christmas gifts? David's going, what did she give me? Who eats more Christmas candy or treats? Who is more likely to say Die Hard is a Christmas movie? Oh. Just so you know, I got Die Hard the Christmas movie kids book this year. It's one of my gifts to myself. And in our family, I buy the better gifts because I actually bought my gifts from Lisa. I said, don't even wrap them, Lisa. I already know what they are. So, who is more likely to reuse wrapping paper? Yeah, okay. All right. Who loves Christmas the most? So you're a Scrooge? Yeah. All right. Four questions about family. Who decided, now you both had to be involved in this, but who decided to have another kid? Okay, and if you have not heard, what, June. Same week as Fuge?
No,
Fuge is in July. All right. When it comes to disciplining the kids, who's the softy? I didn't see that one. Okay. Who appreciates the beard the most? You lie?
Because it's been a long time, and I did, and she was like, oh, I'll put
Put it back. Put it back. Okay.
Didn't say that she thought it looked good. She just thought it looked better.
All right. Who? One last question for me. Yes, him or her. Who gets the kids ready for church? Yeah. Okay. So we figured. All right. I want to ask one last question, and this is, you got to have the mic. So the question is, tell us one thing about your spouse, and you both have to answer, that you do not think we know. All right, one thing about David and one thing about Holly, that we probably don't know it. Now, I get it. Some people out there know a lot about y'all, more than they should. But give us something that most of us probably don't know.
So, as you can guess, he did once have hair. But when he had hair, he liked to change it multiple colors. It was like blonde and black and brown and once blue. So,
you know, we can paint the head.
I guess. It's just not the same.
Not the same. Okay. All right. So can y'all imagine David with the blue afro?
It was never that much hair.
All right.
It wasn't a Bob
Ross.
Never
that much hair. All right. Give us something about Holly.
She actually, I didn't know this at first, but she's an incredible artist, especially like visual arts, with drawing, but like realism. She took art classes super seriously, which, you know, I love that because I love drawing, and that was one of those things, like we'd known each other for a while before I saw, and she hasn't done it in a while because we've both been a little bit busy. But no, like amazing artist, with, you know, pencil and paper, you take your pick, but incredible.
Did she ever draw you? Do you have like a...
It's hard to improve on this.
All right.
How can you make it look this humble?
Yeah. I'm going to ask one last shocker. Cecil, is there anything you want to know about either one of these two? Where did you come from?
I'm actually Central Virginia born and raised.
What's your hometown?
Born in Lynchburg and grew up there until third grade, and then we moved to Forest. So I'm not far.
Believe it or not, Houghton, New York, it's spitting distance from Canada.
That explains a lot.
Well, I wanted to grow up free, so I moved to the South.
All right, let's give him a hand. Thank you. One, that is going to be a lot of your younger kids are going to be coming up to him. And I realize a lot of the younger kids actually had him because you teach kindergarten. And Holly, is she back at school teaching little kids? What is she?
Four and down.
Okay. Oh, those kids. All right. We're going to move in a little bit into our worship of the sermon and the challenge from the Word. And I want to challenge about we're going to get two big words before we walk out of here. And one of them is the word Noel. Noel is actually French in origin. It means, yay, there's a baby. Okay? And it became intentionally tied in with Christ. Now, if you're a guest, you may not realize we have two roses over here, and this has nothing to do with the song, but it symbolizes, and we mentioned a couple of weeks ago, the two babies that have been born to our church family, the Baldwins and the Broggins. So I don't know if any of the family are here. Those roses are for their family. But back to Noel. Noel is a word that is heard. We sing the song, and we sometimes don't realize what it is, but it basically means yes. Noel, the birth of a child, the birth of the Christ, the birth of the Messiah. It is a beautiful, beautiful word that talks about a beautiful, wonderful, marvelous God. So Christy's going to come and share a testimony and song about the word Noel. See? Excited.
Let me try this.
Thank you.
Savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born.
I want to give a personal word of thanksgiving and gratitude for Patrick, Christy, Chad. Brandon actually has to stick around on the piano. Where'd he go? I don't know where he is, but he's somewhere around. Oh, he's over there. But just Christmas, Easter, those are great services. Spend time with family, and that's so important. But a lot goes into planning and running and getting this to go smoothly. Yet it is often like Christmas Eve and you're putting a toy together and pieces are missing. You don't, you know, the soundboard has not started shrilling until last week, okay? And get ready, because actually starting next week, we got all our equipment back together. Our computers are going to change and everything might be even a little weirder. It's just chaos. But I think about Christmas and Easter, the great two weekends of the year for church life. It is madness and chaos. If you have your Bibles, we're going to be in two passages. And I tell you, you know the Luke passage pretty well. So go to Revelation 19, and we'll be there in a few minutes. But Luke 2 is I've read it, you've heard it, Linus says it on the Charlie Brown Show. I also want to say thank you for parents keeping the kids in here. I know that is a lot of extra work for you, all right? But I'll try to make this not as boring as most kids think I am, all right? But I can imagine having a baby when you're 15 years old, which is what we think, 14, whatever Mary was something that was what of a shocker, okay? Surprise! All right, we talked a couple of weeks ago about, you know, Joseph and what he probably was going through. But I started to think about all the characters of Christmas. And I thought of the big five, or five of the big ones, and I started thinking, Christmas was really a time of shocker. Christmas was a time of, wake up! Life's happening. Life is not going to go smooth. Babies will cry. All right? Old men will fall asleep. And, you know, things will take place. Power will go out. You know, we did lose power here at the church for a while, and I was wondering, okay, what are we going to do? We'll worship. We will not stop worship. I may have extra blankets because it might be cold, but we'll worship. So I started thinking of, you know, in Luke chapter 2, it says about the shepherds. Let me just kind of read a couple of passages. It says at the beginning, in those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. And you have to understand, to be registered meant we want more taxes. We want to know who you are, we want to know what you own, and we want to know how much of it you're going to give to us. Now, let me rephrase that. We want to know how much of that we're going to take. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria, and all went to register, each to his own town, and Joseph went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea in the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, and to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And it goes on in Luke 2, it says about the shepherds, and then we read later about the wise men. So I started thinking real briefly, what were these characters' world like? What were they going through? And I started to think what we're going through today. All right? Mary, and I didn't even write this down, because Mary, young child, is engaged, going to be married, looking toward Joseph. All of a sudden, an angel. You're under the Roman occupation. You're in a time of you know, servitude to another world country, a foreign country. And an angel appears, says, you're going to have a baby. And I can imagine Mary's thinking, say what? You know? She, in her brain, is mind thinking, I don't think so. You know, you got the wrong girl. I'm still a virgin. I know I've never been with a man. I can't have a baby. But she doesn't say all that. All she basically says is, as you wish. I yield to the will of the Father. But this madness of her life gets turned upside down. I was thinking last year, Calvin and Tiffany were here. She was with child, and I was looking at the pictures, you know, early December, and I was thinking our world will be different. We got a grandkid. Everything's going to be different. We're empty nesters. You know, life is good. We're doing okay. We can travel. Bam! Welcome, Alfred. And I'm glad he's here. But let me tell you, it was a surprise. Matter of fact, later in Luke 2, I think it's verse 13, it says, and suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts. That word suddenly pops out. And in my life, there are so many things that are suddenly. All right, last week, Andrea was supposed to sing last Sunday, and she calls me or texts me on Saturday, dude, got food poisoning. Frankie, did she really have food poisoning or did she back out? Okay, he's nodding. Okay, I never really heard the whole story here. You know, but suddenly my Sunday has to change. You get news from a doctor, suddenly your life changes. But here Mary is, whoa. Joseph, we talked about him. Think about the life change in his, the madness. My life is laid out. I've got a beautiful young lady. She's going to be my bride. Bam, she's pregnant. What? He's been unfaithful. What? And then all of a sudden, an angel appears in a dream. And think about his world. Get up and marry the girl. Get up and go to Egypt. Get up and go back home. It's like every time God speaks to him, God's saying, get up and move. that's got to be mind-boggling. It's got to be hard. It's got to be tough. And then the innkeeper. First you're thinking, ooh, a census. Little town of Bethlehem, they're all going to start coming back. Honey, we're going to be able to put in the new pool in the backyard because of all the people. They're going to stay at the hotel. And then all of a sudden, a pregnant woman shows up when your room is full. I have worked hotel business. I worked in grad school, in post-grad school, and I want to tell you, it is not happy folks when they show up at 2 in the morning and you tell them you don't have a room for them, especially if they had a reservation. I remember, some of y'all remember when, I think it was Irene hit Houston, the big tornado, the big hurricane, and we had thousands, tens of thousands show up in the city of Dallas, and people were making reservations, and we were just saying, we have no room, and they'd show up anyway. And people from Houston refused to get out, so we, you know, they only had a 1 week, and they'd stay 2 weeks. It was madness. We were trying to find openings and sending people all over the city of Dallas. And I can imagine Joseph and Mary were not happy campers. All right? Mary is in labor. Mary is in pain. But the innkeeper probably feels like life is so hard. I try to please people, but I never do enough. You ever feel that way, like you can never do enough? Like, I seem to try to help my parents, I seem to try to help my kids, and it's never appreciated. No matter how much I do, this world keeps throwing more at me. And I just want to kind of scream and just throw in the towel. Some days I'm the innkeeper. I come to my office, and I think life is going to be good that day, and Gene walks in. And then work upon work upon work. Actually, it's more the other way around, but we'll just leave that one alone. Imagine the shepherds. You're out in the field. Life is good. You don't have to hang out with people. You just get to beat up some sheep every so often. You know, it's kind of cool. Just get them back in. Then all of a sudden, angels appear. Not the smartest bunch in the group, at least one of them. You don't go to a newly baby and her mom and say, can I play my drum for you? Have you ever really thought about that song? What idiot plays their drum while their baby's on the first night? Okay? But then drummers are drummers, and we're just going to leave that there, Brandon. I'm going to just stop right there. Okay? But surprise! Get up. Go see a baby. And then the wise men. Whoa! Their life was probably cool. School, studies, writing papers. And there is a beautiful thing of staying in college all your life. And then all of a sudden, this star appears in the sky. Whoa, what is that? That's not supposed to be there. And you start looking through the books, and you start looking through the prophecies, and you go back to some Hebraic prophecies of Jeremiah, Isaiah, and Daniel. And you kind of go, whoa, this means there's going to be a birth. And we follow it. It is the time of the new King of Kings. So what do? They get up and leave everything. And travel. This is not like, let's take a plane ride to Dallas for 3 days. This is, let's travel in the desert for months. Let's give away gifts to someone I've never met and then travel back. Their world was torn apart. But there was something in common with all of them. I saw a video and I want to show the video. It's a song that has been edited and converted. But to me, it shows what each of these characters did and how they responded. Let's watch the music video, and then I'll come back and talk.
I've heard about this baby boy who's come to earth to bring us joy, and I just wanna sing this song to ya. It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. With every breath I'm singing, hallelujah, hallelujah.
A couple came to Bethlehem expecting child. They searched the inn to find a place for you were coming soon. And there was no room for them to stay, so in a manger filled with hay, God's only son. Flocks by night to see this baby wrapped in light. A host of angels led them all to you. It was just as the angel said, you'll find him in a manger bed. At which you were there, frankincense and gold and myrrh they gave to you and cried out, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Maybe not that exact word, but they worshiped. And the beautiful thing is, each of them worshiped in their own way. There are people in this room that would love for us to do upbeat music all 60 minutes, and there are others that would want the old hymns, and then there are those that say, let's not even sing, let's just pray. maybe there's some of y'all that just want to hear me preach for an hour. Okay, maybe not the last one. But I look at these five groups, and the Bible says Mary treasured it in her heart. She had humble submission. And there may be some of you out there that your response, and hallelujah, should be that humble submission. Say, God, whatever you want me to do, I'll do it. It may be shame to the world. It may be that it might be easy for me. But God, whatever you want me to do, I'll do it. That's worshiping God. Or maybe you're Joseph, that, God, I am unhesitant in my obedience. You tell me the marching orders, and I will march. I want to remain faithful and just, and I will be sacrificial, and I will love others even if it's not easy for me to love. I can imagine it was not easy for him to look at Mary early on until the angels appeared and showed him what was taking place. But he kept that sacrificial love and that unhesitant obedience to God. Or the innkeeper, maybe some of you are a creative in your service. You might use your art. You might use your creativity. You might use your music. Whatever God has talented and gifted you with, by giving it back to Him for use, that is worship. That is responding to God and saying, hallelujah, God. And hallelujah means God be praised. Yahweh be praised. Or maybe some of you are like the shepherds. You hear about it, you want to find out, you come to church, and then when you hear about it, man, it makes you excited. And you talk about it. You go home and tweet, and you go home and Facebook, and you're just bubbling. That's worship. But maybe some of you are like the wise man, where your long journey to get to where you want God wants you to be, and you fall down on your knees, and you're humble in your adoration, and you give to God from your very best. And you don't do it for the king to know about it or the religious leaders to know about it. All you want is, God, I want to give you my best. In quiet service and adoration, I humbly fall to my knees. Where the shepherds went out declaring to the whole town, the wise men slipped away to return home. The point is, all of those are worship. All of those are declaring hallelujah. The word hallelujah only appears in the Bible in two books. It shows up in Psalms, and it shows up repeatedly in Revelation 19. In Revelation 19, it says, after this, and it is a worship service in heaven. The elders, the saints, you, me, everyone has gathered around the throne. And it says, hallelujah. And it says, after this, I heard what seemed to be a loud voice and a great multitude crying out, hallelujah. Salvation and glory and power belong to the Lord. We say hallelujah. There are five times we say hallelujah because He has saved us. You should worship Him because He has saved you. He deserves the glory and the praise because you did nothing. It was Him, and He did it for joy. For the judgments are true. Hallelujah. Salvation and glory belong to God. And the judgment are true and just. For He has judged the great prostitute who corrupted the earth with her immorality, has avenged on her blood and His servants. Once more they cried out, hallelujah. The smoke from her goes up forever and ever. And what that is saying is that we are saying hallelujah because God is a just God. He does not let sin go unpunished. And there's only one way to heaven, and it's through Jesus Christ. And all else, God's not going to let him slip by. And I know that's cruel, but what it says, it says God loves you enough to get you out of that. He loves you enough to come to the cross and bring you back to heaven. And for that, we should cry out hallelujah. And the 24 elders and the living creatures fell down and worshiped God and seated on the throne. And they were saying, amen, which is, it is true, hallelujah. And from the throne came a voice saying, "Praise our God, all you His servants, you great and small." You show up to church, and I am so glad you're here. You watch online, and I say I am overwhelmed with joy. The ministry that we could have, the opportunity. But my question is, if you look back to 2022, did you worship God? I'm not talking about did you show up to church. I'm not talking about did you sing the songs. I'm talking about did your very heart of everything you do worshiped God. And for some of you, it is falling on your knees in humbleness and adoration and saying, "God, whatever you want out of my life, I yield." For some of you, it is, "God, my very best, I give." For some of you, it is declaring loudly to the world, "He lives." But for all of us, it should be, "Hallelujah. God has saved us. God is sovereign. And God loves me." So this Christmas, I looked back and I said, I did not worship God like I should have in 2022. There were days I went through the, I felt like it was a job. And I'm not talking about out of a grudgery or out of you know, just whatever. But sometimes I just organized and planned, and it really wasn't where the heart of the worship was God. The heart of the worship was make sure it runs smooth, make sure the sound works, make sure everything's good. And I have made a commitment to myself that in 2023, I want to be a person that says, I worship God. When I'm at home, when I'm in the car, again, it looks different for all of us. The theme of Christmas we had this year is the heart of Christmas, is Jesus. So my challenge is this, is the heart of BJ Jesus? Is the heart of Cecil Jesus? Is the heart of David or Heather? Is the heart, you know, is the heart of Carolyn? Is the heart of Kelly? Is the heart of every person that's in the hearing these words? Can you say the heart of Todd, the heart of Lisa, the heart of Calvin? Can we say the heart of me is Jesus? To love the Lord my God with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. It won't be easy, but it is what God wants us to give. It is not an invitation where you come down. It is an invitation where right now I'm going to ask us to bow our heads and just say to God, "God, it is you that I want to worship in 2023. It doesn't mean I have to join a monastery or become a preacher. It means as a student, you're first in my life. As a nurse, as a teacher, no matter what goes on, I cry out hallelujah. When life is hard and suddenly things change, like Mary and the innkeeper and Joseph and the shepherds and the wise men, God, it is still you that I look for and I keep my eyes fixed on you and I say this word, hallelujah. I don't want to wait till 2023. I want it right now. So God, may you be at the center of everything in my life. In Jesus' name, amen." Thank you, Brandon. I pray that you worship God like you've never worshiped Him before. I was asked this morning, and I hate to go to the Harris's house to have lunch because Kevin always asks me, "Todd, what are you going to do?" You know, church, and I'm just kidding, Kevin. I love it. But it is the aspect of this, Todd, what are we going to do in 2023? And I give you this answer. I want us to worship God more. Whatever that looks like, I want it to be worshiping God. Glory and power and honor belong to Him. So as our praise team makes their way back up, we're going to sing an unconventional Christmas song. It is, "Oh, go, hallelujah." Okay? That's the actual name of the song. And then in parentheses, your love is amazing. Because if you want to know a reason to worship God, just think about his love. From the cradle to the cross to the crown, he deserves our praise. Hallelujah and hallelujah. Would you stand as we sing our closing benediction?
Love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain, firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. Where I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes
just about 90 seconds. I want to say thank you all for being here on Christmas morning. I know there are a lot of places you could have been. I just want to say thank you for being here. Remember, no activities this evening. Andrea, come up here. All right. The food poisoning girl wants to take a short video. Is that right, a video or a pan? Yeah, I know, but is she this bossy at home? Oh, man. David, when you did the premarital counseling, did this come out at all? No, okay. All right, we're going to get a video of you saying Merry Christmas, all right? But I also, and then I got one thing after that that'll take about 10 seconds. So stand up, all right? Back, all right. Man, you are needy. All right, everybody say Merry Christmas. All right, did you get it? All right, here's what I want you to do. How many of y'all have something on you, you're wearing something that you got for Christmas this year? All right, so before you leave, you either have to point that out to somebody. If you're not wearing anything, then tell somebody one thing you got for Christmas this year. If you got a bearded light, that's scary. One thing. May God bless you. You are dismissed.